All right, welcome back. Today is Wednesday, October 7th. And today is Sutta Nipata 51, continuing Kokālika Sutta, Thanissaro's write-up, a follower of Devadatta slanders Venerable Sariputta and Venerable Moggallana, and after suffering a painful disease falls into hell immediately. And that's called anantarika, anantarika, meaning not antara, meaning no interval, karma, meaning immediate return because of the nature of his activity. The sutta then gives a graphic description of sufferings awaiting him there. Last time I read through it, the heart of the sutta where Gautama is addressing, or this may be also a composite sutta, where there were several people, as well as Gautama, addressing Kokālika before his death, and then talking about his situation. The heart of the sutta, in terms of Buddha Dhamma teaching, I think, is the second half, which is Gautama explaining about Kokālika appearing in the Paduma lotus hell, red lotus hell, for engendering hatred in his heart against Sariputta and Moggallana, who were the two chief disciples, but particularly creating a schism in the Sangha, which is basically trying to harm the community, splitting by his hatred for those two, or his tale-bearing or lying to Gautama about those two senior monks, to cause harm to the community of those who are seeking virtue and release. That's kind of a big deal. And so hurting the people who are actively trying to purify themselves in virtue and seek release and be of service to others. Now, you can say that everything's karmically just, and so everything that everybody experiences is fair in a karmic measurement. Meanwhile, in the present moment in time and space, there are beings who are actively seeking virtue and truth and development and service, or those who are at least not making any trouble for anyone as well, and harming them, the innocent, and the virtuous or the seeking, carries a higher karmic weight, liability, transgression, than doing the same harm to someone else. And so I want to read the Gautama's long teaching on how to Kokālika and the others who were addressing him, how one does evil and goes to hell. And this is the middle of the Kokālika Sutta, translated by Thanissaro Bhikkhu. Quote, Gautama, the line before is, this is what the Blessed One said. Having said that, that was something else he said. The one well gone, the teacher, said further, surely, Gautama saying, quote, surely, when a person is born, an axe is born in his mouth with which he cuts himself. The fool saying a bad statement. So wrong speech. Whoever praises one deserving censure, or censures one deserving praise, accumulates wickedness with his mouth, and in that wickedness finds no ease. So, two forms of wrong speech there also. Not just saying things that are harmful, but also deceptive. Praising the harmful and censuring the virtuous. Next to nothing going on. Next to nothing is the bad throw when one loses money at dice, but great is the bad throw when one gets angered at those well gone, the seekers. For 100,000 Nira Buddhas and 36 and 5 Abuddhas, one who maligns noble ones, directing his words and heart toward evil, goes to hell. He goes to hell, the one who asserts what didn't take place, meaning claims it happened when it didn't, as does the one who, having done, says, I didn't. And both low-acting people there become equal in hell after death, in the place beyond. Whoever harasses an innocent man, a man pure, without blemish, the evil comes right back to the fool like fine dust thrown against the wind. And we'll see that in one of the chapters of the verses of Dhammapada. One devoted to the strings of greed slanders others with his word. Faithless, stingy, miserly, mean, devoted to divisive tales. And this is the linkage between desire and vice. Meaning, the stronger the desire, the more difficult to not do harm to acquire the objects of those desires. And so, moving out of desiring as a whole, particularly desiring akusala dhamma, which is another term for evil, actually. The Buddhist term for evil is papa, like father, papa. I don't know if that's any relation there, but papa, translated commonly, you'll see in the Dhammapada as we read it, called evil or wickedness or sin or harmful conduct, just the same as akusala dhamma, akusala, not skillful or really not beneficent. I'm not sure the etymology of the word kusala, but unwholesome activity. And so going on, you with your hard road of a mouth, untrue, ignoble, destroyer of progress, right, trying to split the Sangha, evil, doer of wrong, lowest of men, wicked, degenerate, don't speak a lot here, you are headed to hell. You scatter dust to your harm. You, an offender, you malign the good, and, having engaged in many sorts of bad conduct, are going for a long time to the pit. Not forever, for a long time. For no one's action is annihilated. The persistence of karma. Surely its owners get it back. An offender, the fool, sees suffering for himself in the next world. He goes to the place set with iron spikes, the sharp-bladed iron stake, where the food, as is fitting, resembles a ball of heated iron. Very similar to Dr. Louise's experiences, actually, in Nosalar. When they, the hell wardens, speak, they don't speak lovingly. They, the hell beings, can't run away. They're not going to shelter. They lie on ashes strewn about. They enter a blazing mass of fire. Tying them up with nets, they, the hell wardens, strike them with hammers made of iron. Truly, they go to a blind darkness that spreads out like a fog. That's the naturalistic upper hells, I'd imagine. Then they enter a copper pot, a blazing mass of fire in which they cook for a long, long time, bobbing up and down in a mass of fire. There, the offender then cooks in a mixture of blood and pus. In whatever direction he leans to rest, he festers at the touch. There the offender then cooks in an ooze where worms live, and there is no shore to which he can go, for the cooking pots all around are all the same. Then they enter the sharp sword leaf forest where their limbs are cut off. Seizing them by the tongue with a hook, they, the hell wardens, strike them, dragging them back and forth. Then they come to the vetarinin, hard to cross, with sharp blades, razor blades, and there they fall in. This is the ocean, the river of lie. Similar to Cherubitus, or one of the rivers of hell in Dante's Inferno. There they fall in, the fools, evildoers having done evil deeds. There, while they wail, voracious black and spotted dogs, jackals and flocks of ravens chew on them, vultures and crows pick at them. How hard indeed is this way of life there that offending people come to see, meaning they come to experience all that. So for the remainder of life here, a person, heedful, should do his duty. These or those loads of sesame seeds compared to the Paduma hell have been calculated by those who know as 5 times 10,000 crore plus 12 times 100 more crore is 10 million. So beings in the lower hells living or staying a longer time, but not forever. The length of the hells of suffering described here is how long the hell beings will have to dwell there. So when in the company of those who are pure, admirable, excellent, One should constantly guard one's words and thought. So there are all sorts of extrapolations and teachings that can be distilled from this. First of all, is the notion that there are people who could be rightly called pure, admirable, excellent. In today, you know, with the radical relativization of all human concept, meaning, Putin said, today in the West, a belief in God is equated comparable to a belief in Satan, that those are considered relatively equal just in that they are beliefs. And we should, Western society, looks upon them equally, one, belief in God, two, belief in Satan, with radically different moral prescriptions, radically different moral positions. He was commenting on that. This teaching comes from, like I said last time, the underlying view that there are absolutes in this relative ocean of birth and death, in the realm of seven dimensions or multidimensionality, where beings experience impermanence and insubstantiality and stress and reincarnation. All of that, where the constant is only change, everything's always changing. There are relative universals, or there are universals in that relative octave, multidimensional scheme of time and space and beings appearing to have experiences changing over time. Within all that, there are some absolutes, such as that which supports greater well-being and that which goes against it, that which leads us closer to ultimate freedom and release, and the end of the transmigratory experience. And there's that which does not. There's that which binds and that which supports the release. And that's the a root presumption that there is activity that supports, that there is a goal, there is a worthy goal to human life, and that's full freedom, release from pain and distress and confusion and any form of binding, mental, physical, emotional, spiritual, and that's done by work on self, which is work on body, mind, spirit, which is work particularly on seven chakras, which is work on what we are, the original desires that entities seek and become one, said Ra. And so there are many people who would believe there's no God, there's no purpose, there's no original desire, since there's no God and no purpose. And life is willy-nilly, comes and goes, means nothing. The meaningless life lived in a flicker of time before it's annihilated forever. That's the materialist view, the nihilist view, the atheist view, the Marxist view, dialectical materialism. That's somewhat absorbed in science or modern science, scientism. That's somewhat repeated in culture heavily these days. Even psychology is essentially personal and materialistic. That doesn't mean that they don't recognize the value of certain ways of thinking and conduct so as to increase well-being. But the well-being is not understood in a spiritual or reincarnational multidimensional context. This is an important matter. And that's why lots of wanderers or spiritual mind people feel much deficiency going to common, ordinary, regular psychiatrists, psychologists, counselors, social workers. Because they carry a materialist bias, a materialist worldview. And that's just common. One doesn't have to go to hell carrying a materialist viewpoint, of course. There's ethical humanism, so they say, which is ethical, more or less, as much as anyone can be. But focused on the human, not the divine, or not the transcendent, or not the multi-incarnational or multi-dimensional, But Buddhist teaching is essentially multi-incarnational, multi-dimensional, and you cannot take Buddha Dhamma away, or you cannot take the concepts of karma and reincarnation out of Buddhism and have it remain Buddhism. And so there is some attempt to do that these days by some closet atheists or closet skeptics or something. And Buddhism is not, again, theistic in that there's a sense that God judges, but there's an understanding that karma judges. And so this is on the page, one of the pages that I linked or sent links to, which we've done before, the description of Naraka in Buddhism called the hells, also called Niraya. Naraka is Sanskrit, Niraya is Pali, usually referred to as hell or hell realm, closely related to Diyu, the hell in Chinese mythology. And the you know, Wikipedia, again, is I don't, you know, condemn it universally, just as it pertains to articles on certain very politically controversial, culturally sensitive matters. But here, in its introduction to lots of philosophical concepts, it's all right. And in the first paragraph on the Wikipedia page on Naraka, a very important point is written, that a Naraka differs from the hell of Christianity and Islam and Judaism, if they fully have those notions, in two respects, differing from the hell of Christianity, which is called Gehenna. Firstly, beings are not sent to Naraka or the hells as a result of divine judgment or punishment. It's not God judging. But that needs to be qualified. Secondly, the length of a being's stay in a hell is not eternal, though it's usually incomprehensibly long. And there is some notion that the hell, in Buddhism, there is some notion that the hells are purificatory, or they purify. And that after the stay in hell, one is reborn back into the human world. I think that's commonly the case. I think that, however, like we see in the No-Solar story, there are beings who incarnate in the human directly from the lower astral, which is the metaphysical terminology for the hells. And reincarnating into the human directly from a lower astral is problematic, because there wasn't a full life review, healing, and preparation. And so you have a number of beings who are coming in, and as we without preparation to be human again. And what happens commonly is they pick up where they left off last time, last incarnation. And they're commonly very happy to be in the physical. Like we said before, elitists, illuminists desire to live forever. I mean, the higher levels, I think they don't really play that game. But for the mid or upper middle, who are technologists, there's this desire to live in the body forever. But part of that impulse, I think, comes from a desire not to go back to where they came from, not to go back to the lower astrals where they came from directly. And so, next paragraph, Wikipedia, a being is born into a Naraka as a direct result of its accumulated actions, karma, resides there for a finite period of time till that karma has achieved its full result, till it's been worked off, or till it is exhausted. After the karma is used up, or exhausted, or fully ripened, it will be reborn in one of the higher worlds as the result of karma that had not yet ripened. And so there's all this karma that the Buddhists have had a hard time explaining, the persistence of karmic energetics for a beingness of a no-self, or reconciling teachings of no-self, anatta. Which is, you know, you can say it's no self, but again, it has to be unpacked. So teachings of anatta with the teachings of karma and karmic load and karmic seeds not yet ripened, held where? How? By a stream that is not of a solid substantive self or entity. That's a sort of philosophical tangle or juggle. And It doesn't matter to me because I think that it's, if we understand that the physical is a manifestation of non-physical energetics, like non-physical energy fields, meaning seven energy fields of the seven chakras, seven bodies, right? So we have the energy fields that could be associated, called bodies, associated with the lower triad, first, second, third chakra, that have relation to what's called an astral body, the type of form or vehicle used by beings in any level of astral plane, which Ra calls 3D time space. That very useful explanation, bringing in raw material metaphysics into a Buddhist understanding of the persistence of karmic load despite the lack of a substantive, eternal self-entity. And Ra saying that they become light, realizing all of the energetics of the octave, the light that is the basis of seven rays, or intelligent energy as the photon of light, or prana, or the particle, or whatever it, however it's conceived, as a substrate of seven rays, vibratory conditions. That has a relative substantiality, and that ultimately would be known to be the form or vehicle of the self or identity in sixth density, meaning in sixth density, knowing we no longer seek light, we become light. They believe we've become light. Actually, they've not become light. They've come to realize the non-separation, the non-duality of apparent environmental and apparent internal identity of a self, that the outer and the inner is one unified field, and I is that field. Yet there's a source of that field, the source of light. That's the logos, and that's where Ra goes, dropping identity in seventh density. They say, we'll drop identity and memory. So they drop the identity as light. They no longer experience memory and identity, and that's on the way. That's a mid-stance between higher self and Parabrahman, I'd say. Meanwhile, back to hell. Just as with many, many traditions, many, UFO friend and foe, Trevor James, What Dreams May Come, Robin Williams movie, No Salar, all in line with this statement from the Wikipedia page on Buddhism on Naraka. Physically, Narakas are thought of as a series of cavernous layers which extend below Jambudvipa, the human world, into the earth. So a series of cavernous layers extending below the earth that we see into the physical earth. There are several schemes for enumerating the Narakas and their torments, bop, bop, bop. And so the Mahayanists in China went to town on it. And from the Wikipedia write-up on Diyu, from Chinese, it looks just like a Chinese city, like Chang'an in the old days. Wikipedia says, Diyu is the realm of the dead or hell in Chinese mythology, loosely based on a combination of the concept of Naraka, from Buddhism, traditional Chinese beliefs about afterlife, Taoist really, and a variety of popular expansions and reinterpretations of these two traditions. So everybody added their 2 cents or 2 cash, little coins, and what came from India regarding lower underworld cosmology of underworld or hells, lower astral, was patched onto and modified and patched onto further modified Taoist teaching on underworld, further modified over centuries by a range of popular folk superstition religions, local myths, local notions of different gods and things like that from the Chinese culture. So, DU is typically depicted as a subterranean maze with various levels and chambers, to which souls are taken after death to atone for the sins they committed when they were alive. The exact number of levels in DU and their associated deities differ between Buddhist and Taoist interpretations. Some speak of 3 to 4 courts. Others mention the 10 courts of hell, each of which ruled by a judge, the 10 Yama kings. And other legends speak of 18 levels. And so then you have a great administrative situation. And from Taoism, Buddhism, traditional folk religion, DU as purgatory that serves to punish and renew spirits in preparation for reincarnation. And so suffering as renewal, as purifying by fire, by pain. A being that has set up the conditions or the causes for those experiences and hopefully will learn from it. doesn't always happen. Commonly, the being has to, you know, fall down for a long time before they realize that they don't have to fall down and they're making themselves fall, and they have option to not fall, and they can do it. I can do it. I can not take the road most traveled upon which I've always fallen. I can take what I think is a better way, particularly in thought, word, and deed, you know, in how we're thinking about things, and particularly how we manifest in our speech and activity with others what we're thinking and how we see what we need. We come to realize, I've been making trouble for myself and I don't have to, and it's not inevitable. It's not made by the universe or you, it's made by me. I got myself in, I see, and now I know I can get myself out. As I said last time, obviously the religious conception of the underworld is heavily layered conceptually by the culture from which it's born. So Chinese has sort of administrative, a very heavily administrative hell imagery. And other cultures have it their own way. And while there are naturalistic hells, which probably predominated in ancient times, hell evolves over time as well. And I believe that actually there is a notion from a Taiwanese novel, Journeys to the Underworld, that says that new hells with new punishments are created as the world changes. And so new punishments or new hells, new environmental conditions of hell are fashioned over the centuries in line with the development of technology and civilization on the surface. And H.G. Wells, Time Machine, all those scary, strange, googly-eyed creatures also under Earth, subterranean. So that's why spelunkers beware. If you're a cave, people who love walking in caves, absolutely not unusually cross paths, if not physically, then energetically, astrally, with hell-dimensional beings who... in which there's basically some kind of co-locationality or overlap between the physical and the lower astral non-physical in some of the underground caves. And there's all sorts of stuff going on. Malta is a big place for that, and not to be toyed with. There are certain cities, there are certain towns, there are certain portions of the countryside where there are cave structures that very much really do go down to levels the physical levels associated with astral dimension, and black magicians and people who are on the negative path do that willfully for various reasons, and people who get into trouble do it and get into trouble. That's a different matter. So there's no doubt to me that there really are hell realms. And it is also just an interesting point that Buddhism and Taoism and the Eastern and Hinduism, the Eastern religions, all teach that stay in hell is temporary. And all say that it's lawful. It isn't the fiat decision, the fiat result, the result of a fiat decision, a diktat from the big boss. The big boss made the laws of karma, yes. And when you drop the cup and it smashes onto the ground, did God do that? Well, God or the Logos, the one infinite creator, eventually established the laws by which dimensions are created and maintained, created the laws of light, created the law of karma. The law of karma as the, basically, the interactive, the inevitable interplay of light with itself. The light associated of thought, and then the physical principle, the physical world, in which every action has a equal and compensatory or complementary or somehow associated reaction, action-reaction, cause-effect, kama-vipaka. That's all the law of karma is, except it's extended to the non-physical dimensions of mind and associated with rebirth into different dimensionalities and bodies. But the West went a certain way, in a bad way, or some of the bad ways of the West. Individualism, I think, is great, but the West has fallen into a toxic individualism, I think, while the East has its own issues with collectivism, toxic collectivism. But they're sort of midway between traditional collectivism, the individual subservient to the state, or to the family, actually. You see, before the individual was subservient to the state, or that individual submitting, subordinate to the state, which we see everywhere in the world, or we see that tendency everywhere in the world, every nation, east to west, where the state wants the individual subordinated to the state. Before that, in the East, you basically had the individual subordinated to the family system. And so, like in the traditional Chinese, Japanese nomenclature, you say your family name first. Mao Zedong, the family name is Mao. Li Tongkwei, you know, the family name is Li. Mandelker Scott. Hello, Mandelker Scott. And so it sounds kind of weird in English to say Jones Bob. Hello, Jones Bob. Or Smith Jane. Hello, Smith Jane. Jane Smith. That's, I think, associated with the traditional conservative Eastern subordination of the individual to the family system. That can be toxic or not. Confucius was trying to detox it and put it in a certain perspective where, you know, the ruler is subservient to the will of heaven. And if virtuous has the mandate of heaven, the ministers and the court are subservient to the king, the people of the nation are subservient to the ministers and the king, the family system is subservient to the father. The father is subservient to the state. The mother to the father, the children to the mother, the younger children to the older children. Nobody is subservient or subordinate to the younger children. That's why they have cats and dogs or dolls. But that whole system works perfectly if everybody's virtuous. if the king is virtuous because king, I guess, is a guy, knows the way of release or values virtue, the value of virtue, highly valuing, rightly valuing virtue, which is basically wisdom and compassion, or truth and kindness and balance and win-win, non-control or support for all, then the whole system can work quite well. I think the East, just as an aside, is probably transiting from some kind of confused collectivism to a confused individualism. They're not quite fully in toxic individualism, but depends on the nation, depends on, it's quite individual. So the point here is that there is virtue vice, there is harm and benefit, there is that which supports release and that which binds further. And so what's good is ultimately that which supports release. What's bad or papa is actually that which supports further binding, whether you know it or not. On the other hand, or from a different view, some people may say, don't do that, it's bad, when it isn't bad. And or when there's nothing really that much bad about it. And very interesting, in the write-up, where was that? There was some discussion, I think it was on Wikipedia, where, so Kokālika was a follower of Devadatta. And Devadatta, this is actually on the page Anantarika Karma. And this is the worst kind of karma in the Buddhist system. Quote, heinous crime that through karmic process brings immediate disaster. Anantarika means on antara. Anantara means not antara, like an atman or anatta, mean not atman. Anantara means no interval. And so Anantarika is a being who's experiencing non-interval rebirth. Results immediately come to fruition in the next life, or the person cannot live much beyond the commission of the activity that's considered the crime or the sin or the wrong action or speech. These are considered so heinous, this is the Wikipedia page, that even non-Buddhists must avoid them. That's a strange thing to say. That's where you get strange things in Wikipedia. I mean, the purpose of Buddhism is not to make Buddhists. It's to actually help beings free themselves from suffering and go from desire and discontent to peace and clarity and increasing freedom. So Buddhists and non-Buddhists ought to avoid what leads to further pain. Committing such a crime prevents the perpetrator from attaining the four stages of awakening in the life, and these are the big five in terms of sins or crimes in Buddhism. Intentionally, not by accident, but intentionally murdering one's father, one's mother, or killing an arhant, which I guess is possible. They killed Mahamoggallana. Shedding the blood of a Buddha, because you can't kill him unless he wished to be killed. And then, number five, creating a schism in the Sangha. And that's what Kokālika was doing. And interestingly, with some, this may be a useful curio for some people, in the section on Devadatta, who tried to throw a large rock at Gautama, and incited an elephant to kill the Buddha, where the Buddha pacified the elephant by sending him metta, loving-kindness. According to Sutta Pitaka, meaning the suttas were from which we're drawing eventually, after trying to kill Sakyamuni Buddha or Gautama a number of times, Devadatta set up his own Buddhist monastic order by splitting the Sangha. And that's what Kokālika was supporting. During his efforts to become leader of his own Sangha, he proposed five extra strict rules for monks, which he knew Buddha would not allow, right? Make you an offer you can't accept. Devadatta's reasoning as, oh, so clever, Devadatta's reasoning was that after he had proposed those rules and Buddha had not allowed him, Devadatta could claim that he followed and practiced the five rules, making him a better and purer monk. It's clever, and stupid. So, establishing... this is international politics. Geopolitics looks like this all the time. Threatening to do something unless you do, you know, kind of blackmail. I'm going to punch you. I'm going to do this and that and the other thing if you don't do X, Y, and Z. Setting up more and more unreasonable demands that are known will likely be rejected, or known will surely be rejected. So then one has the rejection of those demands, which are all unreasonable or excessive or manipulative and outside reasonability. Certain rejection of my unreasonable demands will then give me, or I will then use that as a justification to do something that I always wanted to do. And so what he always wanted to do was set up his own Sangha. And then by saying, the Sangha must do these things, and Gautama said no, he smiles and says, good, glad you said no. I will now set myself up as the leader of another Sangha or a split in the Sangha because I'll do these and you won't. One of these five extra rules required monks to be vegetarian. Ha, 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 ha. So, not to put down a vegetarian, but Chinese Buddhists think that Gautama was vegetarian. Here we see the Sutta Pitaka referenced in saying that this was one of the rules that evil Devadatta proposed to Gautama, which was rejected. Which was considered unnecessary by Gautama. I'm sure there are some people using their vegetarianism, obviously, as an imagined basis of superiority. Yeshua said, not what a man puts in his mouth that causes sin, but what comes out. I think that's true, and I think Gautama would agree. But there were rules against killing animals or eating meat from animals known to be killed for you, or having the monk call for an animal to be killed to eat the meat. But aside from that, you didn't have to be vegetarian. And so it's just interesting that that was one of the five rules proposed by Devadatta, who tried to kill the Buddha and created a schism, and he shed blood of the Buddha, and then went to hell. And that was bad for him. And so accounts claim that toward the end of Devadatta's life, the boss of Kokālika, he was struck by a severe remorse caused by past misdeeds and did indeed manage to approach Buddha and retook refuge in the Triple Gem, so he joins, then tries to create a schism and put himself on top of the other order. Then he's thrown out. Then he was allowed to retake refuge, died shortly afterwards. He was condemned to suffer for several hundred millennia in Avicii, in one of the lowest hells. And it was also said he'd eventually be admitted into the heavens as a Pratyeka Buddha. I'm not sure about that. So, there you go. Some food for thought. Now, the Dhammapada stanzas on evil, Dhammapada 9, explain, you'll see some, I mean, in general, the Dhammapada was compiled from Gautama's direct teachings, utterances, in response to particular situations in the community, in the Sangha, in the lay community, in the greater area of wherever he was traveling, and Magadha and that whole northern India zone, but particularly the affairs of monks and lay people brought to his attention or directly witnessed. And so we'll see some basic teaching here on avoidance of evil or harmful activity that leads to further binding. So, Dhammapada 9, translated by Thanissaro, it's stanza 116 and on. Be quick in doing what's admirable. Restrain your mind from what's evil. When you're slow in making merit, evil delights the mind. If a person does evil, that's the word papa or akusala dhamma, he shouldn't do it again and again, shouldn't develop a penchant for it. To accumulate evil brings pain, and that's the whole point. What's called evil or bad is called such and valued lower than something called good or virtue because it brings pain. Going on, if a person makes merit, he should do it again and again. He should develop a penchant for it. To accumulate merit brings ease. So accumulation of evil brings pain. Accumulation of merit brings ease. So that's a very interesting dichotomy or juxtaposition there. The opposite of pain, not necessarily pleasure. I mean, we can say it's pleasure, but we can also call it ease or consider that the opposite of pain is ease. Ease as well-being, as comfortable with oneself, which means increasingly comfortable with everyone or anyone. Now, it's hard to be comfortable when people are cursing you, hating you, spitting on you, punching you, this and that. It's not assumed that one would feel ease with that. It's assumed that one would make right action or right speech, right action, right response to move away from such a person. But pain, you can see, I mean, you know, it's very, for those who see mind through the face, you can see the mind of pain through the face. Likewise, you can see the mind of ease through the face, and the mind of ease is a mind of merit. And a mind of, a face of pain is a mind of sin, or harmful activity, or chronic penchant for that which is harmful to self and other. To call it evil, you know, it's a little heavy-handed word. But there is that which brings pain, and there's that which binds further, and there's that which tangles, and there's that which is a misrepresentation. To say it happened when it didn't, to say I did it when I didn't, to say he did it when he didn't, to say it's up when it's down, to say it's good when it's harmful, to say I'm happy when I'm not, to say all's cool, I'm okay when I'm not. It's called dishonesty. All that could be called evil or wrong or bad simply because it binds one further. Stanzas 119, 120. Even the evil meet with good fortune, as long as their evil has yet to mature, right? So karmic ripening in time. But when it's matured, that's when they meet with evil. So the evil one is the evil person is the evil doer. And it's not really an evil being. It's a being doing evil, attached to it, clinging to it, valuing the fruits of what could be called evil or harmful action, service to self. That's all. And yet they won't experience it fully all the time, the consequences of that, because there are other karmic seeds ripening before the ripening of the seeds of their akusala dhamma. Then even the good meet with bad fortune, as long as their good has yet to mature. But when it's matured, that's when they meet with good fortune. So karmic ripening over time, the last shall be first and the first shall be last. I think that's what we will see with the current Sanjigen or third density end times outcome, is that just like the movie Mars Attacks, the cute, strange, comical, grotesque movie of Tim Burton, in the end, who wins? Well, the kind, the very innocent, sweet grandmother who's senile, the senile, sweet, pure grandmother who loves country music, and her grandson who loves her and goes out of his way to help her, who's very sweet, and the president's daughter, who is as good as she can be, and cute, and kindly, and not interested in any kind of games, and a black family of an ex-boxer who have two little boys and a mother who's working hard, and the father comes back to be with them, and he's doing his best. And a new age woman, a Shirley MacLaine type, very well played by, what's her name, the woman from American Beauty. Great. She always plays the same role. She's always the same, but she makes it, despite her being love of wisdom, new agey, who initially welcomed the Martians and said, welcome to Earth, our friends. And Tom Jones makes it. And some birds and deer and squirrels make it. And the Mexican orchestra makes it. And everybody else gets whacked. And the civilization falls apart, and America seems to join with Mexico. The last shall be first, and the first were taken out by the higher evil of the Martians in Mars Attacks. Passion play, morality play. Very interesting movie where lots of A-list actors get killed in absurd ways. That's strange. And that looks to me like the first becoming last after the tribulation. You heard it here. Going on. Verses 121-22, which have a asterisk for some reason, just on some notes. Don't underestimate evil, quote, meaning thinking, it won't amount to much. A water jar fills, even with water falling in drops. With evil, even if bit by bit, habitually, the fool fills himself full. Don't underestimate merit. It won't amount to much. A water jar fills, even with water falling in drops. With merit, even if bit by bit, habitually, the enlightened one fills himself. So merit and evil, or accumulation of karma, positive merit, negative evil or harmful ways, is slow, gradual, imperceptible even. Yes, yes, yes. And, you know, what's really critical is who you hang with. And that's one thing. And then what you do when you're alone. Who you hang with is who you shall resonate with. And what you do alone is really where the mind goes. And Rick Wiles, True News, talking about some Christian view. A man, somebody said, you know, a man is really measured by what he does alone in private. That's true. Not only, but anyway, karma is very much imperceptibly accumulated, and this is an interesting point also that could be elaborated on. Going on, I'll close up this sutta, this Dhammapada chapter. Like a merchant with a small but well-laden caravan, a dangerous road, like a person who loves life, a poison, one should avoid evil deeds. So, one should avoid evil deeds and speech. Like a merchant with a small, well-laden caravan going on a dangerous road, or a person loving life and poison. But the next verse is very interesting. If there's no wound on the hand, that hand can hold poison. Poison won't penetrate where there's no wound. There's no evil for those who don't do it. Who goes to hell safely? Yeshua went for 3 days, so they say. I think that's very reasonable. The No-Solar rescue team goes there regularly. But they don't live there. And so there's some extrapolation useful. Why don't they set up an outpost? I think, number one, they have better things to do. Sorry. Self-sacrifice has value, but it's not a supreme value. Meaning it's very, very useful for souls moving from third to fourth density. And in some cases, it's absolutely the best and right action or response. But not, it's not the path. The path is sacrificing the inessential, not sacrificing my life for you. There's a big difference. And so the sacrifice of my life for you, which is right and good, for those moving from third to fourth density is wrong and distorted for those moving out of fourth to fifth, it seems to me. So sacrifice my future life and well-being for your benefit is unconditional giving to protect the beloved. That's a mighty deed, moving one from third to fourth density or harvesting. But it ain't moving out of fourth density to fifth and sixth. There, seems to me, there is sacrifice. But the sacrifice is of the inessential, of attachment, of delusion, of harmful habit, of the values that are comfortable but unhelpful, comfortably numb, getting beyond the comfortably numb, shattering armor, sacrificing and surrendering that which is akusala in mind and spirit, particularly in mind, really. And so the deep work of transforming green, blue, indigo, that is not done by sacrificing your physical life for beings in every single lifetime. So, but those who have no wound can go to the places of wounding, but they don't live there. Poison doesn't penetrate where there's no wound. Some people can walk into the middle of a real infection, a real pandemic, and not wear any protective gear and walk out okay. It's very common. I mean, you know, there are very saintly people who hug lepers, not leopard, lepers, and people who are, you know, clearly contagious with virulent, lethal, you know, bacteria and viruses, if there are such. And by love, they're protected. And so love as the greatest protector is the way of healing wounds. The way of healing our wounding is love. And that leads to a certain protection from poison, from the harmful. And particularly leads to uprooting desires that lead to harm. That's the point. Protection from harm is non-triggerability to act in ways of harm. Non-triggerable because one doesn't have the underlying distortions to be triggered. Associated with not having the underlying desires for such activity that would be triggered into manifestation. Not being triggered, truly untriggerable. That doesn't mean keep a stiff upper lip. Stiff upper lip. It means not suppressive. Honest, sincere, willing to feel, willing to freely think, but in that not being triggered to emotional charge or harmful response of speech and deed is of freedom from the underlying desires to engage in such activity. The willingness is no longer there. Where there's a will, there's a way. Where there's no will, there ain't no way, and there won't be much triggering. And that's the purification of motive, purity of motive. And that comes from being more and more well, at peace. And so as merit leads to ease, to accumulate merit brings ease. That ease de-triggers one, is a de-triggering, is a deep, harmful root cutting, dissolving phenomenon. Going on, like a merchant with a small but well-laden caravan, a dangerous road, like a person who loves life, a poison, one should avoid evil deeds. If there's no wound, this is the same, isn't it? Or maybe I'm reading the same, okay. If there's no wound on the hand can hold poison. Poison won't penetrate where there's no wound. And likewise, those that are trying to get our goad or goat, or get us to be crazy, or to provoke us, will fail when we're not triggerable. It's like we look at them and think, what are you doing? I don't believe what you're saying, so I won't act as you seem to want to provoke me to act. But I am observing how distorted you are. Whoever harasses an innocent man, a man pure without blemish, the evil comes right back to the fool like fine dust thrown against the wind. That's right from Kokālika Sutta. Some are born in the human womb, evildoers in hell. Those on the good course go to heaven, while those without effluent, asrava, totally unbound. And so that's birth and dimensionalities. Born in the human, is the human realm, one of the six in Buddhism. Hell, evildoers go to hell, or Naraka, Niraya, one of the lower states of woe. Those on the good course, or merit, with merit, go to heaven, or go to higher Kamaloka and Rupaloka. Those without effluent, totally unbound, leave the octave. And finally, 127:28, not up in the air, nor in the middle of the sea, nor going into a cleft in the mountains, nowhere on earth or off earth, is a spot to be found where you could stay and escape your evil deed. Nor from past lives to today. And I had a very dramatic experience with that once. Not up in the air, nor in the middle of the sea, nor going into a cleft in the mountains, nowhere on earth, is a spot to be found where you could stay and not succumb to death. So, everywhere, in any dimensionality, not only on earth, can one escape karmic stream. One can change it, of course, but that doesn't eliminate it. It just means that it's modified or diluted. Then there's nowhere one can go to avoid death, and that really means the end of a body in a dimension. That's the point. Buddhism is most suitable for those who are tired of dying. not necessarily tired of living. Tired of living may be a reason for more rebirth, but tired of dying, at best, is one who no longer gets a kick from champagne, and no longer gets a kick from incarnation or sensuality or even mental activity. This is really, I mean, the guys around Gautama, they were tired of becoming. They really didn't want anything more than release from the round of becoming, birth and death. And that was their single desire, radical purity of motive, or focusing of motive. That was their only motive. And so that's not for everyone, and that's a certain level. Let me just see if there's anything from the Dhammapada chapter 22 on hell that I'd read. I think this will be enough for today. We're getting close to the end, and I'll wrap it up with this. Let's just read the last few. Ashamed of what's not shameful, not ashamed of what is, beings adopting wrong views go to a bad destination. So these four verses, 316 to 319, Dhammapada 22, hell, talking about hell and wrong view. So, ashamed of what's not shameful, like I'm ashamed to be studying in the library, reading ancient Buddhist texts because all my friends are at the party, but I'm such a loser, I'm reading on Buddhist texts or something. That's ashamed of what's not shameful. Not ashamed of what is. Beings adopting wrong views go to a bad destination. Seeing danger where there is none, and no danger where there is, beings adopting wrong views go to a bad destination. Imagining error where there is none, and no error where there is, beings adopting wrong views go to a bad destination. Finally, but knowing error as error, non-error as non, beings adopting right views go to a good destination. And so the heaven for the virtuous, a good destination, higher rebirth, and then freedom eventually from all rebirth, very much depends on right view. And so right view is the basis of right speech and action, which is the basis of sila, virtue, morality, ethics, which is the basis of samadhi and prajna, of course, meditation and insight and awakening and release. But particularly, right views leading to right speech, action, and livelihood, or non-harmful ways of mind and speech and action, or kusala dhamma, wholesome ways, is the basis of merit. And merit is the basis of going to a good destination. Right views lead to right actions, or right activity of mind and body and speech and thought, belief. So right view and right thinking, right view comes from basically sincere seeking. The people who, sincere and persistent seeking. There is effort required to keep seeking to know. And there's effort required to put into practice what we know. Right? In the movie The International. Excellent, excellent movie. Clive Owen explaining banks and debt very deeply, and all sorts of tangled international play, corporate play. Talking about one of the meeting in the New York office of the DA or something or other, saying nobody wants the truth because the truth demands some kind of responsibility. I forgot the right quote, but the hardship of truth, the burden of honesty and revealing the truth, is that it compels action in accord with the truth. You know, when you know it, when you know what is, inevitably one must deal with it. And in general, the normal way of dealing with truth is to live in accord with it somehow. But if you're not using truth to manipulate and control, which can be done, you're seeking to accord your thought, word, and deed with the truth, with any truth, with whatever is real. That is a responsibility and a burden and a piece of work. And seeking truth leads to continued responsibility. Like the result of good works is more work. Yeah, right. The capable one has more demands put upon that one. And the finder of truth can't really forget what they found, and somehow must factor in that truth that they cannot forget, that they've seen clearly, into all future thought, word, and deed, and their views and their activity and their lifestyle and their way in the world. So the burden of truth is the responsibility of action in accordance with it. And yet that's one must be willing to take that to develop right view. Right view is truth of, our condition and the truth of the basis of my condition, the causes, and the truth that I'm in some discomfort or some well-being, both, and that it's really better for me to eliminate the further causes of my unwellness and further the causes of my current wellness. That's kind of better, I'd say. But that may require some changes and update and letting things go and taking in other things and making effort in accord with what I now know as helpful and harmful, or causal to the helpful and the harmful. The causes of merit and ease versus pain. And so it takes a strong stomach and it takes strong will to persevere in seeking and living in accord with right view. And yet then that really would, because it's really the right view of what brings long-term welfare and benefit, unbinding greater well-being. That's the right. That's the view. Those are the types of views that are here called right or wrong. The views of what makes my future? What makes my future? Well, my views and my speech and action make my future. The speech and the action come out of certain views. Those views are not fully in the light of truth, but partially, and partially mistaken. And where they're mistaken, it's quite likely that my speech and action will lead to consequences that harm me and you. And where there's harm to me and you, it can be traced back to the causes in speech and action that are traced back to the views that are wrong. Oh, I thought that you meant to put me down. I thought that you were doing those things, but I see you're not. Dot, 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 dot. And so anyway, right view of life and self and path and goals and value, right values, you know, value, a value scheme that leads to greater well-being. These are the important views that need to be made right. Self and life and purpose and path and goal. These are the principles of spiritual evolution that are critical, seems to me. And adopting right views anent all that leads to merit, leads to ease, leads to going to a good destination, leads to long-term welfare and benefit, and doesn't lead to hell. Meanwhile, we can see beings in, you know, Ross said, Earth life offers an adequate hell and a more than adequate, an adequate heaven and a more than adequate hell. If we look carefully at the mind of beings around us, we can see somewhat what dimension or what realm in which they live, actually. So, because they're there, the mind is there now, not yet the body. Any case, I hope that was helpful. It's pretty heavy. Next time, we're going to continue with Sutta Nipata to the next sutta down the line, which is Nalaka Sutta, the second to the last of the Mahavagga chapter, translated by Thanissaro and Olenziki, gurgling loudly or to Nalaka. It's really about to Nalaka. And Thanissaro says, a sutta in two parts. The first part gives an account of events soon after the birth of the Bodhisattva, meaning Gautama, soon after his birth. Second part describes the way of the sage. So we'll look into all that next time. And it's a long sutta. So we'll see. We may take 1 or 2 weeks on it. In any case, I hope that was helpful. And there's much more to say, but I can't say it today. And I hope you can make use of this information to get a clearer right view on how action brings merit and ease or leads one to harm and possibly rebirth in a lower zone. And then take that clear eye to seeing more clearly the people around us and the society and changes. So, thank you again. I hope you're all well. Please take good care of yourselves, and good night.